Hello and welcome to GryphonArt, and today I want to show you how to make this presentation pen and or pencil box. Now, as always, I do like to show you the box before we get creative just to ensure that it is actually of interest to you. So let's take a closer look. So as you can see, the box has been embellished with die cuts and some embossing paste and some little faux pearls as well. And I will be going through these with you later on in the video in case that they are of interest. The sides of the box have got these mock tabs. They're purely decorative, not functional. And again, we've got these little embellishments here. Again, they're not functional, although they are fixed over a functional hinge. Now, I don't know, let's bring this closer. This section here, so this little section here, forms part of the hinge for the lid. It's made out of card, which may be of concern to some, but because this is a double thickness and it's also sandwiched together with a very flexible PVA glue, I am very confident that this hinge will have longevity. Now, with the box itself, it's very sturdy in construction. It's made of layers of card. And if we take a look inside, you can see that the walls of this box are very thick. And this is mirrored with the lid itself. Now, I have actually used the layering mechanism for this, but I will point out during the video where certain components can be replaced with artist mount board or chipboard if you have that sort of product to hand. Now, inside, you can see we've got these little pen trays. There's two, so this will take a pen or a pencil or a combination of both. The closing mechanism on this particular box, there's no magnets, there's no tabs, the thing that keeps this box closed is this component here. So all we need to ensure during our construction process is that this component fits snugly within this aperture, and I will be showing you how you can be confident that that's the case. Now, pens and pencils come in all shapes and sizes, particularly pens. So if you start getting into the realms of fountain pens, they tend to be a lot thicker, so they have a greater diameter. Now, this box does allow for these little pen trays in here are actually a half inch on all these three sides. So if you're writing implement has a half inch diameter or less, it will probably be fine in this box. However, it was a concern to me, you know, that you might have a favored pen and it wouldn't fit. So the way I've designed this box is such that everything is based on these pen trays. So might not be for a beginner, but if you've got a reasonable experience of making boxes, altering the size of this box is not going to be too onerous, because once we've made these pen trays, you'll see everything else fits to those pen trays. So if you have a pen or a pencil that's larger and you want to have a box specifically for that, you will still be able to use this box design, just altering one or two measurements to ensure a bespoke fit. Right, so I think that's actually all the information I can give you by way of introduction to this box. So I may as well bring in my scoring board and we can start to make some progress. Now, as I indicated a few moments ago, we are going to be starting with those internal pen trays, which are dictating the rest of the sizes for the box. Now, one thing I should have perhaps pointed out to you, and I wanted to make you aware of, I've actually specifically designed this box for my much loved Faber-Castell propelling pencil. Now, you could fit your pen tray tightly to your pen size, because you've always got the option of turning the box upside down in order to get at your writing implement. However, I just wanted to make you aware that I have made the pen tray longer than my writing implement here, and that's to enable me to gain access to that pencil from the top without turning my box upside down. So I just wanted to make sure that you could take that into consideration and make a qualified decision as to whether you also wanted to factor that into your own sizing. Now for that particular size pen tray, I'm starting out with a piece of card that's 2.5 inches by 7¾ inches in size, and I've placed that on my scoring board in portrait mode. Incidentally, it's probably worth me pointing out at this stage that if there are those of you out there watching the video who are very experienced with box making, there is a PDF document, and I will put that in the description area for this video. So if you feel that you know what you're about, you can certainly go and just download that document, and you've got all your card sizes, some scoring indications and some diagrams, along with a lot of notes that should see you through. Obviously, there's going to be more hints and tips in the videos because it is a classroom style video, but you know, if you're experienced, you can probably just pop along and download that, and you'll be able to get on very well. So for those of you who are still with me, I've got my first piece of card in portrait mode. I'm scoring on the wrong side of the card, and I'm going to be initially scoring at the 1/2 inch mark and again at the 1 inch mark. And because I want the sides of my box to be even, I'm just going to flip that over and repeat that process on the other side of the card. So I've got 1/2 inch intervals, and there may be a slight discrepancy in the base. At this point, I can turn my card into landscape mode. And again, I'm going to be scoring at 1/2 inch to start with. And because I want my pen trays to be equal in length when they're side by side, I'm not going to flip in this instance. So I'm just going to score at the 7¼ mark. Now, as you've seen, this particular project does require 2 pen trays, so I'm just going to repeat this process with a second piece of card exactly the same size, and then I can come back to you. Right, so the next thing that we need to do is to simply fold and crease all of those score lines, and this is fairly straightforward, so I won't do all of this on camera. I just wanted to point out to you that when you're doing this, unless you're absolutely sure that your card is square, don't worry too much about whether the edges are lining up. It's more important to ensure that your fold lines on one side of your card are lining up nicely with the crease lines on the other side, or the score lines. So this edge here, when you do the next fold, should line up nicely with this score line here. And as long as you do that, then you should end up with a nice square project. So I will continue and get all those folds in place, and then I'll come back to you. Right, so I've now got 2 pieces of card which have been scored, folded and creased in exactly the same way. And all we need to do now is start to create our pattern piece, and that means taking away some excess card. Now the first thing that we're going to do is to remove a small corner section. And I tend to also remove all the fold line, simply because they do tend to get in the way of construction, and you know, so it's worth getting rid of them. That's just my way anyway. So I'm doing the same thing. Having done that to this end, I'm going down the long length and finding the opposite corner, and I'm doing exactly the same thing. So we've now got that sort of shape going on, 2 corners out. Now the next thing that we can do, working on one end away from this corner, we're going to snip into the first fold line just down the middle to the intersecting fold line to create a little tab. And we'll do the same to the next fold line as well. And that's giving us 2 small tabs, 1/2 inch roughly. Now we're not going to do this next one. We're actually going to turn the corner and repeat that process there. So you end up with a tab on this side. I don't know whether you can see, that's the sort of shape that you're aiming for. So that now needs repeating to this end here and duplicating on the second piece of card. So I'll get that sorted and come back to you. Right, so with both pattern pieces now prepared, and there is that diagram in that PDF document if you're still a little unsure of what you need to be doing, so that will help you as well. So we're now going to start forming the sides of our pen tray. The only thing to bear in mind here is that the sides are actually folded on the wrong side. So they're going to be hidden. These raw edges of the side of our box are going to be hidden. So this is the inside of the tray. So that's just what you need to bear in mind. So all I'm going to do in the first instance is take one side, doesn't matter which side, but one of these long sides, and I'm going to just apply pressure along that fold line and crease it back this way. So this is how the pen tray is starting to form. This is where our pen will sit. And that means that this raw edge is going to be hidden from view once the box is constructed. So all I'm going to need to do is to glue that in place. And I'm using PVA glue. I find it a strong glue for card, and it's nice and flexible as well. It doesn't dry brittle. So the one thing I will say, I tend to use my fingers, and recently I've found that as long as I've got a damp sponge to hand, I can quickly clean my fingers off. So that does help as well. So just spread that glue around. Keep that tab out of the way. And then I'm just going to apply some pressure with my bone folder and make sure that that is glued nicely in place. A PVA does take a little longer than some glues to go off, but you know, that can give you a little bit more opportunity for making sure everything is where you want it to be. Excess glue oozing at this point doesn't really matter, because all of this side of your card is going to be hidden. This is not the decorative side. So all I will need to do next is to repeat that process with the other side of my pattern piece. So it's just a question of creasing that, so I end up with three of these panels which will form the inside of my pen tray on the right side. So I will glue that in place in the same way that I did the other side, repeat that to my second pattern piece, and come back to you. Right, so just for further clarification, this is now the shape that you should now have. So these little tabs on one end, and then you've got this nice soft edge on either side of the long length of your pattern piece. This is the side where your pen is going to sit, and those raw edges are now alongside the base on the bottom. So that's what you're really looking to have at this stage. Now it is possible that your card may be curling. I just wanted to point this out, as mine is. You can see a bend in that card there, and I don't want you to worry about that. As we progress, there'll be more components added to this section that will straighten out any curve that you may be able to see at this point, so please don't worry about that. Right, so now what we can do is look at drawing up and constructing the little ends to our pen tray. And in the first instance, it's these two little tabs that we're going to be working with. So we're just going to be gluing one in front of the other. So let's just get started with one. Now it doesn't matter which way you do this, you know, whether you put it behind one, the center one behind or in front, it doesn't matter at this stage. So either way is fine. So all I'm doing when I'm putting these together is I'm just trying to make sure that I've got a nice right angle edge going on here so that my pen tray remains as square as possible. So that's something for you to look out for. Now the other thing that may be pertinent is that I tend to switch from my standard bone folder when I'm applying pressure here. This is fine at this stage, but you'll see as we get to close this up, you've got less space to work with. So at that point, when I'm applying pressure, I've swapped over to a smaller bone folder. Now, if you haven't got one of these, something that's got that sort of blunt edge to it, small edge, a knitting needle or something like that will probably be an appropriate substitute. So that's just a little tip. So let's do this end as well. Just a small amount of glue. Get that nice right angle in place. Give it a moment to go off and apply some pressure. So I'll swap to the other end again. Now, with this end, if you've not seen my videos before, I do tend to deal with these last tabs at the same time. So I do glue them up simultaneously. I find it causes a lot less risk of you having little access. If this is now drawn up, you can see that you've got a lot less access at this end. So I find it best to glue them at the same time. So it's just this little lower section of that tab. So just that end section, both ends. And there is an order to these. These do need to go on the inside of your pen tray, just so that you've got neatness. You'll see in a minute how that's working out. So I'm just going to draw these onto the inside, apply the same, take the same approach, make sure everything's nice and has a right angle to it. And at this point, my little bone folder comes into play, and I just apply some pressure there, just so that that glue takes. Now the final task is, and this is why this last tab that we've done is going on the inside. This final little bit of tab is going to be folded over to give you a nice, neat, soft edge here. So it sort of brings the whole thing into place. So I'll just apply glue on this side on either end and fold them over and glue them in place like that. And that will finish our pen tray. So I'm going to get to the same stage with my other pattern piece, so I have two pen trays exactly the same, and then I can come back to you. Right, so we've now got two pen trays that are of a very similar size, and we need to glue them together to form a single component. Now I've already applied some PVA glue along long edge of one of these trays. But one of the things I'm going to do, we now do need to give consideration to appearances. So I know that's still going to be sticky along that top edge, but I'm removing any glue that is likely to ooze, because I don't want that to show on the finished product. So that's just something that I wanted you to be aware that I do. So it's then just a question of lining up the ends, making sure that these are nice and flush on both ends, bringing those sides together and applying pressure until you're sure that that glue has taken. Now, with PVA, that does take a little while, so I'll make sure that I'm happy with that off camera in the interest of time, and I'll come back to you so that we can start on the next component. Now, I did just want to come back to you very briefly on this component, because I should have pointed out something else to you before. I did mention that you want to make sure that these sides, these end sections, are nice and flush so that the pen trays are the same length and side by side. But sometimes there can be a discrepancy in the height of these sides. So, and if you're on a flat surface, there will be a tendency for one of these side sections to drop slightly below the other. Just try and avoid that if you can. You know, bring them back up as the glue is taking hold. Make sure that the top edges of both sides of the box are in line with each other. It is better, I think, from an aesthetic point of view, to get that right. If there's a slight discrepancy on the base in the height, that can be sorted out later on in the project. So I just needed to make you aware of that. So now that we have that component complete, and this is going to be the guiding component for the size of the box, if you remember, we can now look at creating a little containing box for this component. So we're going to make a second box in the same color that will just surround and strengthen the whole pen tray. So that's what we're going to do next, and that will be fitted to this component here. Now, in order to do that, I'll bring in my scoring board again and we can get started. Now, for our pen tray containing box, we're going to need two pattern pieces exactly the same again. So we're dealing with two pieces of card that is In this case, it's 1.5 inches wide by 8.25 inches long. And I do just want to point out to you at this time that if you have increased the size of your pen trays in order to take a specific pen size, you may need to be thinking about extending the width and the length of this so that you've got enough card to work with. Now, because we're fitting to the box, there aren't many scoring lines. In fact, there's only one. So we're in portrait mode, we're scoring on the wrong side of the card, and we're simply scoring at the 1/2 inch line. Now, I've got two pieces of card. I've already done one in the interest of time, and this one is already folded. So that's the one I'm going to be working with initially. So the first thing that we need to do is to fit this section, this new patterns piece section, to our pen trays. So I'm just making sure that that crease is nicely in place. And all I'm going to be doing is lining up the top edge of this because I want to find out where the corner occurs. I'll need my pencil for this initially. So I'm just making sure that it's flush with the end of the box, the raw end is flush with the end of the pen trays there. Just lining up, you don't want an angle on this because it will alter the length. So just line everything up. When you're sure you've got the right position, you can just put a pencil mark in on that card, which indicates where your next corner is going to be. So that's your next score line. So at that point, just get rid of that, you can place this on position, that pencil line, on any groove of your scoreboard. The only thing that you need to do is make sure that you place your pattern piece so that it is flush and tight up against the edge of this upright section on your scoring board, so everything's going to be nice and square. Then all you need to do is put your burn folder over the top of that mark and score your line. Now, if your card is particularly thick, you might just want to drop it down and flip that over and score through the single line so that you've got everything nicely positioned. And you can then fold and crease that line. And you've got your corner position. Now, if we try and bend that at this point, there's some resistance because of this fold. So in order to ease that, and that will become worse actually, the thicker your card is. So in order to make that easier, on this top folded over section only, we're going to be removing that fold line. Just get rid of it. Just gets in the way. There we go, that's gone. And that means that our ability to fold that corner has become much more easy. So the next thing that we're going to do is find our next corner. So we're just repeating the process. So I'll continue with that. So all I've got to do there, and I'll do this off camera to save time, is again, mark my pencil line, score it, fold it, and I'll come back to you at that point. Right, so I've repeated that process just as we did before to create a second fold which represents the next corner of my pen trays. Now, I don't need to remove a fold line. I'm actually going to remove this whole corner, including the fold lines. It's not just the fold line that I'm removing. And this is beginning to form a fixing tab for those two pattern pieces. Now, in order to form that fixing tab, I need to know where my base comes to. So we just fold everything there, line those top edges up on the edge here so that the raw end, that tab, is at the end of the box. The main thing is to make sure that these edges are nice and flush at the top here. So once you're sure of that position, you can then create a pencil line just on this end tab section only. You just want to know where that baseline is occurring. And at that point, you can then cut away the excess card at the bottom of this little fixing tab. So I'm going to cut slightly above the pencil line because it tends to come below your baseline when you're drawing it. So I'm cutting just slightly above. And then again, removing that fold line. And that is leaving you with a little fixing tab. So this is the shape of pattern piece that you should have at this point in time. Now I did mention that we need two pieces of pattern exactly the same for our containing box. So this was the second piece of card, exactly the same size, that 1.5 by 8.25, and scored at 1/2 inch and then folded and creased along that line. So we can now use this section of card, this pattern piece that we've created, as a template. You could go through the whole process again, but actually it's easier just to rest one on top of the other. Deal with one line at a time, because they may not be exactly 1/8 of an inch apart. So just place one line on your scoring board at a time and go, where's my other bone folder actually, and just position them. And once you're happy that they're over a relevant groove, you can apply that pressure and form that fold line. So that's all you're doing. So I can now fold and crease, and that's giving me a duplicate pattern piece. So you can follow that on with the next score line. So just place it on, fold, and then cut away so that you have two pattern pieces exactly the same. And I will do that off camera and come back to you then. Right, so now that we've got both pattern pieces prepared, we can look at joining them to create one long pattern piece. So I'm just using one of these little tabs, doesn't matter which, and you might be able to see I've already applied some PVA glue there. And I'm just going to line these up so that they're in exactly the same direction, so the other little tabs there. And I'm just going to join them together using that tab, just making sure that these fold lines are all lining up neatly. And I'll also, once it's had a chance just to take hold, I'm going to show you up close how I've positioned those two pieces of card together. Just make sure that's taken properly. Right, so I want you to be aware of this. So all I've done is I've pushed the raw end of this pattern piece here up against the ridge that the fold line created when we made that little tab section. And what that means is that it leaves a little bit of a gap, see that, both at the top and the bottom. And you do want that, because it's mirroring this other section here, if you like. So don't try to push these two pieces together so that the edges come together. You do want this slight gap. Just push it up against the edge of that fold line and you should be about right. Now, having done that, and with that having gone off, the next thing that we can do is to glue down some of these flaps. Now, these first three, so you start where you've got this little remaining tab that is going to be our next fixing point. I'm just going to start off by gluing these three down. You see me glue quite enough, I think, today. So I'll glue them down off camera, and because this final one is treated slightly differently, I'll come back to you at that point. Right, so when we come to do this last section, we're still gluing that down, but I've already applied my glue, and I'm hoping that you can see that I've left about 1/2 inch at the end of here free from glue. So having done that, I'll just apply the pressure in a normal way and just get that glued down. Now, just one thing is, if you've got a lot of glue on, make sure that you drive away from that dry area, because you don't want any glue oozing in and reducing that area that is dry. You do need to keep that so that those two pieces of card are separate in that area. Now, before we move on to the next section, I will show you why that is. It's because when we come to join these last remaining sections, we want this little fixing tab to slot in between, and that will form a nice neat finish. The bulk will be even on the inside of the box. You've not got this extra little tab on the inside. It's just a neater way of doing it. So, if you choose to stick it on the inside or even on the outside, that is your choice, but this is the method I employ, and I find it works well. So that's the reason for that. So having done that, we can now look at applying this second component to our original pen tray components. And in order to do that, all we're going to do is apply glue to the sides of our pen tray, in phases. So I'll start with a long length. So the last section that you want to be gluing up is the section with the tab. So just apply glue in the same way. And again, just applying it in such a way that you are mindful of that top edge, which is going to be visible. You don't really want too much glue along the top edge, as long as the sides are reasonably well adhered, that should be fine. So, there we go. Just clean my fingers a bit. So, we're just making sure that the corners all line up, that raw edge is also in place, and it just flush with that end section. And these top edges are coming together nicely. So those are the things that you're looking out for. You know, if you bend the component around the edge, you're going to have an idea of whether it's positioned properly or where you want it. So just making sure those top edges are flush as much as possible. It's only because it provides a neat finish, really. Just working your way along. And once that glue has started to take a bit of a hold, you can lay that down onto a flat surface, knowing that it won't move, and apply that pressure just to encourage it a bit more. Across that front edge, keeping everything in line. And then once that's taken, that fold line just needs to be cut into. We can now see where the base of our box is, so we know how far it needs to go. So we're just going to cut into it to the base of our box. So in order to save time as usual, I'll glue up this one onto that section and this one as well, and cut into that corner, and I'll come back to you at that point so that you can see how we're going to fix this end. Right, so now we've reached this last little end flap here. In order to make life a little bit easier for us, we're going to trim back this flap just a little bit so that it goes in more easily. So I'm just going to take the edges off, just angle it. And you can do a dry run if you want to just make sure that no glue has oozed, which is going to inhibit its positioning. So that's fine. We can see that's going to fit well. So at that point, we can glue this end of the box and also glue both sides of this little tab. So definitely quite a bit on this inside one, slightly less on the outside one, because we don't know how far that tab is going to go into the side of the box, and you don't want perhaps excess glue showing on the outside. It's not too important with this project because we're covering that area up again, but if you were doing this pen tray for something else, then you would just need to bear in mind that decorative aspect. So all we're going to do now is slot that in between those two sections of card, so that folded card, push it home as far as it will go. Just keep an eye on how these are lining up on these top edges as well, and applying pressure until everything is nicely glued and adhered in place. Just apply some pressure on the bottom here. Now that will need to go off a bit before the next phase, so I'll give that a minute or two and then come back to you to show you how to form the base flaps. Okay, so now I'm happy that that glue has had time to go off on that join. I can start to join my or form my base flaps. Now, obviously they need to fold over and we could just push them in place. But actually what I've found is if you use your bone folder or knitting needle or something, put it on a flat surface. I'm going to raise it up here so you can see what's going on. I find it's easy to start with the end ones first. Just use the point of your bone folder along the base of the box as you would using that base of the box as you would a ruler really, and just firmly score a line that will make folding that flap easier. So I'm afraid you probably won't see this on camera, but I'm going to do just that now. So being very, very firm with that line. I don't know whether you can see it. And what that's going to do is immediately that enables that card to fold. It wants to fold at that weak point. So that's worth doing. So you just do that on all of the four flap sections for your box. So I'll do that off camera so that all of those fold inwards, and then I'll come back to you and explain about the gluing process. Right, so those are all my flaps formed and they fold nice and neatly into place. And I have already glued down the two little end flaps because they're quite straightforward and they don't really cause any problems. They've got a lot of strength at the end here. They just fold over nice and neatly into place. I did, although the gluing, I'm not going to do the gluing on camera, I did just want to point out something for you to look out for, just in case it's a good thing for you to know about. When you put the glue on these longer sections, there's less strength on the sides of the box. As soon as you go for long lengths, you've got a weaker component. Short ones are the strong ones. Now what can happen is if you try and pull this too tightly, it can make the edges of your box bow out, particularly in the middle. So once, assuming this has had its glue applied, you can apply the pressure, but apply it on both edges and just make sure you are maintaining that nice square and that, you know, this is not so tight that it's pulling the edges out. So, you know, the gluing is straightforward, but I just wanted to give you that extra thing to watch out for so your glue hadn't set off and you suddenly realized when you turned your pen tray up the right way that these edges were bowed out in the middle. So just something for you to look out for. So I'll finish that off camera and then I'll come back to you. Right, so that's our pen tray component absolutely complete. And I just wanted to show you that these long flaps do not come together. You can expect to end up with a gap down the length of your box centrally. So that's absolutely fine. So we're now able to turn our attention to our main box base. And the first thing that we need to do is to create the strengthening sections that give the sides of our box that sturdy aspect. Now, for this size of pen tray, and allowing for the fact that this stopper section needs to sit inside the box, I've decided that the strengthening sections for this box need to be 11 and 16ths of an inch high. Now, in order to make life a bit easier for myself, and you may not choose to do this, but I've decided to create a template. It's just a strip of card cut off the edge of a piece of A4 card, and it is 11 and 16ths of an inch high. And I can then just use that to cut multiple strips of that width. Now, in the interest of time, I have already cut 10 strips of card using that template that are 11 and 16ths of an inch in height. And we're going to need 5 for each long side of the box. So those are all ready to go. And the next thing that we need to do is ascertain the actual length that this card strip needs to be. In order to do that, we're simply going to take that strip of card. We can get rid of our template now. And do much the same as we've already been doing throughout this project. We're just lining it up along the side of our pen tray component, making sure everything's nice and square and flush. And then we're just going to use our pencil to mark a line. You're familiar with that by now. And that probably won't be straight, that line, but we can now sort that side of things out. So I'm going to place that squarely on the grid of my self-heal mat so that I can just ensure that that line is square. And now I can trim away that excess using that line as my guide. Now I should say at this point that for those of you who like to use artist mount board or chipboard, this component can be substituted. So you can just go through that motion with your chipboard instead of the piece of card and you'll be ready for the next phase. Now for those of you who are going to be using card and the layering process as I am going to be doing, all we need to do now is take our 5 strips of card. This represents one side of our box, and it's up to you whether you want to cut them all to length before you glue or cut them as you go. My approach tends to be I shall glue this in place, so just like apply glue to the back there, line everything up. And then once the glue's had a bit of a chance to go off, I just use my scalpel blade on my self-heal mat and trim it back. So I tend to glue first and trim after. It's entirely up to you which approach you take. But what you're basically aiming for is a lamination of 5 pieces of card that are cut to the appropriate length. So I think that's straightforward enough. So I'm going to do that off camera and come back to you once that's completed. Right, so I've now finished that lamination process and I hope you can see that that's quite a thick component now. But there is one thing I want to say. I have specified 5 layers of card for this lamination process, but it really is up to your own artistic interpretation how thick you want the edges of your box to be. If you're using particularly thick card, you may feel that you can get away with 4 layers, or if your card is thin, you might want to add another layer or 2. You know, you're going to know better than anyone the card that you're working with and how thick these components need to be. So that's the first point. The second point is that sometimes during the lamination process, these pieces of card can bend. As the glue dries, they can bend. Now, it's not really an issue, so I wanted to make sure that you weren't going to be fretting about that. Everything will start straightening out as we construct the box. But if that bend in that component is quite significant, you can apply that technique that you would use when you're trying to curl ribbon, when you're wrapping gifts and things. So if you just place your finger and thumb at the top end of the card and apply some pressure, and you can just apply extra pressure on the side where you want to take the bend out. So in this case, I've actually added a little bit of a bend by applying pressure on this bottom edge, but I can simply return that by applying the pressure in the other direction. So if you need to straighten out these components, that's a method that you can employ. Now, you've probably already guessed that you do need to repeat that process because we need a strengthening section for either side of the box. So you're just wanting 2 components, both 5 layers of card thick, if that's the layering that you're going for, and both the same size. So that's exactly what you're wanting. Now, at this point, we can start to find out what the measurement is that we require for the strengtheners for the end of our box. Now, the strips are still 11/16 of an inch high, so I've already pre-cut those over length, so I've got those to work with ready. But the other thing that we need to bear in mind is that these components are going to be covered with a piece of card to neaten this raw edge. And that extra layer of card is going to be going over the edge of this strengthener and will sit between the strengthener and this pen tray. So we need to make an allowance for that. And I'm simply going to be using some of the bits that I cut off these lengths when I created them. So I've got a couple of pieces of card in exactly the same card that I've used. And I'm going to put those in place. So if I So I've got my component, strengthening component either side of my box, plus those two extra pieces of card. And that is going to give me the width of that end section, or the length, whichever way you're looking at it. So at this point, we can take a strip of card and just place it along that edge. And as long as we've got everything lined up, it's just applying the same principle as we did before. I probably will do this off camera because it's quite difficult for me to see looking through the camera lens. But and I think if I explain it, you'll know what you're doing. So it's just in a question, lining everything up. When you've got it to this stage, you can put your pencil line in. Now, the only pointer that I have for you here is that the strongest point of your box is your base. It's not going to move. When you're holding onto this pen tray sometimes, you can squeeze in the edges at the top and that will give you a false measurement. So when you're taking that measurement, make sure that the pencil mark that you make is at the base of your box. And then you can straighten that mark out, make sure it's square, and that should give you the a more precise measurement. This isn't precision engineering. If you're slightly out, it really won't make too much difference, but you know, I would certainly take it from the bottom of the box rather than the top. So I'm going to do that off camera, get my template in the same way as we did for these strengthening sections, and then build up two laminations of that size, so that I've got two end pieces that are five layers of card thick. And at that point, I'll come back to you. Right, so I've now got two pieces exactly the same, thick strengthening pieces for the ends of my box, and that completes all of the strengthening sections for the box base. And that means that we can turn our attention towards the main box construction. Now for this pen tray size, I'm using a piece of card that is 2.5 inches by 9 inches in length, and I'm scoring on the wrong side of the card, and I'm going to initially score at 3/4 of an inch. I'm then going to turn that card clockwise. Doesn't really matter which way you turn it, as long as you do it the same way for both pieces of card. And then I'm going to score at 3/8 of an inch. Now we need to repeat this to a second piece of card of the same size. So you need two pattern pieces exactly the same. And then you're folding and creasing those lines. So in the interest of time, I've already folded and creased the lines on a second pattern piece that is exactly the same. And the next thing that we're going to do, and you'll see that there's a lot in common with what we've already done for the pen tray container earlier today. And what we need to do is ascertain a fixing tab on this little 3/8 of an inch section. So to do that, we're going to take one of our strengthening sections, because that's the height of that outside of the box. We're going to place that at the end, as we did before, and just mark a pencil line so that we know where that tab needs to be. And we know that the rest of the card is excess card. So all I need to do then is cut away the excess card. I'll do it off camera to save time. So that section is excess and that section is excess, the same as earlier today. So I'll take that away, make sure that I reproduce it on the second piece of card, and then I can come back to you. Right, so I've now got two pattern pieces exactly the same. So the excess card has been removed in those corners, including the fold line, same way as we did this morning. The next thing that we need to do is ascertain where the corner of our box is going to occur. So in order to do that, we're going to take one of these little strengthening pieces, the end section, and we're going to just place that onto our pattern piece, lining everything up, pushing it into the corner and making a right angle with this little tab just to help with the positioning. Once we've ascertained that position, we're just going to, as we've done before today, just make a pencil mark, because that's going to indicate where our next corner is going to be. At that point, we can place that on our scoring board on any groove and keeping everything flush with this top, we're just going to create a score line on that pencil line. Just going to drag that back so that I can get that in place more firmly. And then I can fold and crease that line. That's going to be my first corner, and I'll reproduce that on this second pattern piece and then come back to you. Right, so now both my pattern pieces are the same. I've got that fold line in the same position on both of them. And what I've done, I've already done it off camera so the glue's had chance to go off, but I've just taken the small strengthening section and I've placed it in position alongside this little fixing tab and just in the section where it needs to go. Now, when you're positioning this, you can use these fold lines to make sure that you've got that positioned correctly. It doesn't want to be interfering with the folds at all. It shouldn't do because you've fitted it to the pattern piece anyway. But as long as you can form right angles, then you've positioned that little strengthening section in the right place, and you know that's where it needs to be glued. But you're only doing that on one pattern piece at this stage. Now the next thing that we need to do is ascertain what length is required here, because this card size is over length, and normally for the size pen tray that I've used, we've got about an eighth of an inch that we don't need here. Now to just find out exactly what that is, we could turn this section up at right angles, and that's advisable anyway. Place one of the other strengthening sections in position along that fold line and put the final one where that will be positioned there. But that's actually very awkward trying to draw a line. You really need another hand to do that. So the best way to sort of get around that is, instead of putting this second strengthening piece this end, just double it up this end. So put it alongside the other one. It makes no difference. We're not gluing it or anything. And then we can position our long strengthening section in place, making sure that this fold is forming a nice right angle, because that's how it's going to be. And making sure that that edge of the long strengthener is up against everything nice and tightly. Once that's sorted, you can use your pencil to mark out the excess along the end of that strengthening section. Just a pencil line like that. I can now use a ruler, we've done this earlier today, to extend that pencil line and trim that back. So it's just a question of keeping everything square. Doesn't matter if you've trimmed slightly more back, actually, it will just sit a little bit back from the corner where the join is. So I can now trim off that excess, and once that's done, I can place this pattern piece on my second pattern piece and trim that back to the same length. So I'll do that off camera and come back to you then. Right, so now that both my pattern pieces are of the desired length, we can now look at joining them together to create one long piece, much in the same way as we did the pen tray container box this morning. Now, the only thing I would say here is that it is best to use the fixing tab where there's no strengthening section nearby or already attached to that pattern piece. So use the one where you haven't attached the strengthening section, and that way you've got a flatter area to deal with. So it's just as we did earlier, we're going to lay the pattern pieces side by side, just line up all the fold lines and push this pattern piece here up against that ridge that was created by the fold line where that tab is. And once that's sorted, you can just apply some pressure to make sure that's nicely in place. Now what that enables us to do is to start to put in some of our other strengthening pieces. I'm not going to glue them on camera, but I'll show you what you're doing. So the first one is just a repeat of that first one that you placed. So you'll put that in position so that all these fold lines indicate that that positioning is correct. Now once that one is in position, you can take a long strengthening section and turn the both ends up so that you've got a nice fit between both of those strengthening sections on the ends, and that will confirm that that's where it needs to be. The only thing to bear in mind is when you're positioning this, do try and make sure as well that the top edges of these strengthening pieces are lining up nicely, and that will prevent a ridge occurring in the corners of your box. So that's the only thing to bear in mind. So I'll now go and fix those in place, and then I can come back to you to deal with the last one. Right, so now that those three strengthening sections are in place, we've got our last one to do, and I've already applied the glue where it needs to be on the back of that section. And you can see that I've left about a half of an inch at the end where there's no glue at all. So back to that scenario, this is where that tab is going to come in behind. So this unglued end is going along to this raw edge, almost. Obviously there'll be a space because of this strengthening section. So we're just going to form a right angle as before, place that strengthening section in position, lining it up with the fold line, and just making sure that it is nice and flush at the top here as well, just to keep that nice line. And then just giving it a little time to go off. And you can see that there is about an eighth of an inch gap at the end there, and that's what you're looking for, because you need that space for this strengthening section to rest in. So just let that go off a little bit. So the next thing that we can do, now that we know where our base position is, because this is our baseline with this larger flap at the bottom, is just trim into these corners on the fold lines. We're just going to trim down the middle of these fold lines, and they'll create, in this instance, it's the flap that will fold over the edge of those strengthening sections. So we've got two of those. And then we're going to repeat that process on the bottom here, which is forming our base flap. So just down the centre of the fold line. And again, we have two of those. At this point, we can join the edges of our box together. So we've got that same scenario, and you can do that dry run again if you want, just to make sure that there's going to be enough room for that tab. And then at that point, we can apply some glue to both sides of the tab. So a little bit on this side, not quite so much, and a reasonable amount on this side. We can just tuck that in position. Line up all our fold lines, make sure everything's nice and square on that corner, apply some pressure, and that's then ready for neatening up the top of our box. Right, so the next thing that we need to be clear about is which is the top and which is the bottom of our box. Now the flaps on the top are more or less the same height as the strengthening pieces on the inside, so they're the shallow flaps that you're dealing with. So that's the top of the box, and that's what we're going to be working with. You can see that those base flaps are much bigger. Now the first thing that I want to just point out to you, we're going to deal with the longer sides first in folding these over and onto the inside of those strengthening sections. But if we have a look here, we can immediately see that the strengthening section is inhibiting the passage of the end of this flap. So we need to sort that out. And the way to do that is to just cut away about the width of that strengthening section in the first instance, but we're not going right into the corner. So just cutting down that edge a little bit. And then at that point, I'm going to angle that cut, again, not from the corner, but from about an eighth of an inch up. So we're forming that sort of shape there, and that will you can see how that's going to sit on that corner. So I'm going to do that to the other end and also to this opposite flap, and I'll come back to you at that point. Right, so I've formed those little shapes on all of the four corners of these longer pieces, and I've already put one flap down, and this one I've glued up. It's just in the interest of time. I don't want to waste too much of your time. So I'm now going to show you the method that I use to cover these edges. Now, the only thing I would say is you do need to make sure that you've got glue on those little flat bits, because you need to make sure that they will stick down. So that's the first point. Now, the first thing I do, I tend to use a combination of my fingers and my burn folder. And the first thing that I like to do is just make sure, I know that there was that fold line there, but I just want to make sure it is actually in the right place. So I just follow that crease line to start with. I then start to apply pressure along that top edge with my burn folder and getting onto these little end pieces as well. So just making sure that they're starting to be in the position they need to be. Then I just use my fingers and thumbs, so my first finger and my thumbs, and just run those along that edge, encouraging that card to fold into place. And then use my bone folder again. I mean, you'll get a feel for it yourself, I'm sure, once you start to do this. Just make sure those tabs go down. Once that seems to start to take hold on the inside of the box, I can then lay the box on its side and use my bone folder to apply pressure on the inside along the length and form that nice crisp edge on that other side of that strengthening section as well. Just being mindful of glue at this stage, because we're starting to deal with the decorative aspects of our box, and if glue starts to ooze and gets onto your bone folder, it's surprising how quickly it can end up on the decorative side of your box. So just check your bone folder hasn't gained any glue. Right, so I wanted to show you these corners now that they're in position, and I think you can see that they don't look particularly neat at this point in time, but what we're going to do now is alter this little flap and neaten that up completely. So we're going to use the same system that we used with the long flap. So we're still cutting away the excess that's going to inhibit that flap folding down into the box. So you're just taking a guess at that from, I just judge it from where it's positioned. Now, when I've got to about an eighth of an inch away from this end corner, I then cut, and this time we're going to form a mitre cut. So we're cutting from the very corner, or as close to it as you can get, to that point. So I'm hoping that you can see how that's going to make that corner very neat. We've got a nice little line going into the corner. So I'll do the same here, and you just have to be mindful. You can see that set back, so I won't need to take much off this edge here, and that little angle there is going to be very small. But I'll do the same here, I'll do the same to the other end, and then it's just the same process to glue these flaps down and inside the box. So I will do all of that off camera in the interest of time, and then I'll come back to you. Right, so now that we have all of those upper flaps in place and glued inside our box, the last thing that we can do with this component for the time being is to form our base flaps. And we did a similar thing with our pen tray container this morning, so I'm going to give you a quick reminder of what you need to do, but I'll do it off camera and then come back to you. So all we're doing is we're using our bone folder along the bottom edge of the strengtheners that are in place to form that baseline, and then we're folding those over. Now I do find, because of the space that we've got to work with, it is easier to work and do both ends first and then do the long length. So I'll do that and come back to you at that point. Right, so that's all our base flaps formed, but unfortunately, as tempting as it is to finish this box off, we can't glue those down at the moment because we are going to need access through this space later on, as you will see. So the next thing that we'll do is turn our attention to our lid section. Now, we can see that our lid is the same thickness as the sides of our box. So there's an indication there that we are going to need some strengthening sections. And because our box is fitted to everything, our pen trays, we need to create a template that will be the exact size that we require for our strengthening sections. Now, I will explain the reason why we're taking a little bit off the length in a minute, but in the first instance, the easiest way I've found to create a template is to take our box and set it on a scrap piece of card that's got a nice square edge to it and line everything up so that those edges along a long back section and a short end section are flush with the sides of the box. And at that point, I'll probably do this off camera actually, because it's difficult for me to see. But at that point, very carefully, because you don't want to mark the top edge of the decorative side of your box, you're just going to draw around that box. So I'll get that done and then come back to you. Right, so having drawn around the top edge of my box, I'm hoping that you can see these pencil lines. I've got that outline shape, so that's my starting point. Now the actual size of that strengthening section, end to end, it actually needs to be two thicknesses of card shorter than the actual length end to end of my box. Now the reason for that is that we will be covering those strengthening sections with another piece of card. So that's going to add a thickness of card on at either end. So that's why we're going to take that off this pattern piece. So let's start with that. Now in order to help me with that, I've simply taken a couple of scrap pieces of card and glued them together. So that's my double card thickness that I've got to work with. So all I need to then do is place that thickness of card on that pencil line that marks the end of my box and draw the other side of it. And that's going to space that away. I don't know whether you're going to be able to see it, but that second line a little bit further in is indicative of the length of the strengthening section that I need. So I will cut this piece, when I cut this template out, I will cut to this shorter line here. So that's the first thing. Now, as far as the size front to back goes, I can leave it at the exact measurement from front to back. So I don't need to make any alteration on this template now. I just can cut out that outline using that line I've just drawn in. Now, I do want to explain that to you. So if we take a look at this box lid, the thing that we need to realize is that we've got our width of the box here that you can see front to back, but we've also got within that spacing this hinge, and that is two card thicknesses in total. So that's already adding on that double thickness of card front to back. So that's why we don't bother taking it off on this template. Right, so I hope that's helped to make things clear for you. What I will now do is cut this template out, and then I'm going to need two more pieces of card exactly the same size so that my strengthener is a piece of card that is three card thicknesses deep. So I'll do that off camera and come back to you at that point. Right, so that's my lid strengthening section complete. So three layers of card laminated together. And on that note, for those of you who are preferring to use artist mount board or chipboard, I'll leave it to you as to whether you choose to replace this component with chipboard or mount board. I just want you to pause to think about this, really, rather than suddenly regret a decision. I don't think it's going to matter, to be fair, but we are going to be adding the hinge layer to this, which is comprising of a double layer of card thickness. So if your chipboard or mount board is already quite thick, thicker than three layers of card placed together, then that is going to make your lid component thicker again. Now, I don't really think that's going to matter a great deal. You may need to cut a larger piece of card for the lid cover to ensure that you've got enough overlap because of an additional thickness here. So that's a decision that I will leave with you. Now, speaking of hinges, that's the next job that we're going to tackle. So I've got my piece of card that will form my hinge here, and it is over length at 8¼ inches by 4. So now that we've ascertained the length of this strengthener section, our hinge is going to be the same length. So I actually find it quite a lot easier to use my scoring board. I've got to score anyway. So if I use my scoring board in this instance, I can wedge everything tightly up against these raised sides to find the length that I need. So I'm simply going to draw a line at the end of this strengthening section, and that means that this section of card is surplus to requirements and can be removed. So all I will do off camera is to extend that line across the piece of card and trim this down to size, and then I'll come back to you. Right, so now that my hinge section is the exact length of my lid strengthening section, the first thing that I need to do is to find the point of this edge. So I'm just lining up everything. So you basically, if you haven't got the scoring board to line everything up, I find it quite useful, then you're lining up three sides, so the two short ends and one long edge, with your hinge section. And I'm going to do that by placing it on my scoring board. I'm then going to draw down a line down that edge on the wrong side of that hinge section to find out the width of my strengthening section. And at that point, I'm going to score my line. So I'm just placing that on any groove on my scoring board, keeping everything nice and straight. So that's my pencil line, so that's the width of my lid strengthener. And then I'm going to score again 3/8 of an inch away from that line, and then 3/4 of an inch away from that original line, so effectively another 3/8 of an inch. And that, so I end up with that sort of scoring pattern. Now at that point, I can fold and crease those lines. Now I will quickly do that on camera because I want to explain something to you. So we'll just fold and crease them in the normal way to start with. Now my hinge is going to be operating along this score line here. So I also, having folded and creased that way, I like to also fold and crease this way because it's going to make that hinge more pliable. So we'll just now at this stage, we can form the hinge in a dry run position. And you do need to form a right angle in order to do this, because if I was to leave that flat, let's bring it up to the camera. When that hinge is in a flat position, just notice the front of that raw edge. As soon as I draw that angle up, it's pushing that raw edge forward. So we're trying to ascertain how much excess card we've got. So we just need to keep a nice tight right angle in that card. And then once we've got that, we can mark down that edge. And that represents our excess card, which we can now trim away. So I'll do that off camera and then come back to you. Right, so now that that has been trimmed back, all that excess is gone, we can look at gluing these two card thicknesses in place to finish off our hinge component. So I'm just going to put some glue on the middle here. Doesn't really want to be loads of glue, but you do need to have a nice amount along this hinge section just to protect it, because that's the bit that's going to be bending backwards and forwards. And if you can get the glue into the fibers, it is going to help give it some longevity. I'll just get this quickly in place. Right. So the first thing that we're going to do is make sure that these front and side edges come together and are flush. And not worry too much about this hinge area. We do want to watch out a little bit for any oozing glue, because whilst on this area, this wider area, will be covered, so it's not really a problem. This is definitely our decorative hinge area, so the outside of this will be on display. So that's just something to keep in mind. When glue oozes out of the end like that, it can soon make a mess. So once I'm sure that some of those edges have taken, I can place this down and start to apply pressure to get that together. And I'll start to bring up this 90 degree angle as well and form that nicely. Making sure I clear away that glue. Now I'm doing this on camera because there is a part that I want to show you. But actually, in the first instance, if you just keep working at this until that glue starts to really go off, then we'll get to another part. So I'll continue off camera in the interest of time, and then I'll come back to you to show you the final phase. Okay, so I've continued to work that along those two planes until I'm sure there's no more glue oozing out. It won't have gone off totally yet, but it's beginning to take hold. And what that means is the next thing I'm just going to do is fold this right over and form that crease very firmly. And now I'm going to gently flatten that pattern out, and it's automatically going to form this ridge. I'll bring it up to the camera so you can see. But as you flatten it out, this ridge starts to form. And we're going to just gently draw the bone folder down the side of that ridge on both sides. And that's going to give that hinge that area of card that it will, you know, it can move into when it's bent at that 90 degree angle. But it also means that you can open your box, because if it dried in that position of 90 degrees, you know, it's going to cause some stretching when you come to open up your box as well. So it is, I've found that it is best just to do this. So you just get to that point where you get a sense of how well the glue is going off. As long as it's caught, so it's not going to drag these areas out. You know, you can flatten this out and form that ridge along the fold line, and that will help with your hinge mechanism. It's only because this is a double thickness of card, you know, with a single thickness you wouldn't have this issue, but I wanted the strength along that hinge because I like to be confident that my box designs will last. So there we go. So that can be left to dry out now, and then we can start looking at the next phase. Now the next thing that we need to be considering is our lid embellishments, particularly if you're planning to use embossing paste as I've done here. I've found that it's easier to apply this whilst the cover section is in a completely flat state. So that's what we're going to be dealing with next. Now before we can start stenciling, we need to prepare our lid cover piece. So all I've done is I've taken a piece of card, which represents my main box lid cover component, and that card is 8.25 inches by 2.5 inches. And all I've done is I've put it in my scoring board and I've scored on the wrong side of the card at a 1/2 inch point. And I've just folded and creased that, and that's my starting point. Our next task is to create a little mask for our stenciling area. If we take a look at the box cover, you may be able to see that I've taken a decision to have a little bit of a frame around the edge of the stenciling. So I'm not stenciling to the extreme edges of this cover. Now, in order to restrict the stenciling within a given area, I've found that it's easiest just to produce a piece of card that represents the size of that stencil area. Now, that mask can very easily be produced by using your lid strengthening section, which is very much in the region of the size of your lid when it's finished. Now, all you need to do is to cut out a piece of card that is the same size, so you can use this strengthening section as your template for that. And then you can simply trim it down by 1/4 inch along its length and along the end as well. And that will give you an area that leaves a frame around the top of your box of in the region of 1/8 inch. So once we've got that masking template, what we can do, and I will do this off camera because it does take a little bit of time, but I'll talk you through it here, is you can place that so that it's centrally from either end, and that is quite important to get that as near to central as possible from end to end, so an even border, and that tends to be in the region of just under 3/4 inch, I've found. And then you want to set it back. Use that fold line that you created, and the spacing from the back there needs to be about 1/8 inch. So it's because that's going to fold down the side of your lid strengtheners. So it might seem that you've got a lot of room here, but that's absolutely what you need to have. So at that stage, what I tend to do is I'm using removable tape, so very low tack. This is actually Scotch removable tape, and it's brilliant actually. So I will provide the details for that in the description area. And I tend to just put the tape at either end of my mask to start with, and that enables me to mask off the top area and the bottom area, and then I can remove one piece of tape at a time to do the ends. So I'll do all that off camera and then come back to you. Right, so having placed tape all around our little template mask, we can simply remove that, and that reveals the area that we need for our stenciling. Now the stencil that I'm going to be using for this project is a memory box stencil. It's Raymel and it's style number 88541. Now I'm additionally going to be masking off areas of that stencil with a die cut shape, and it's another memory box product called Sketchy Rings, and that's style 99149. So I'll put the information in the description area for you in case you are interested in those. Now the other product that I'm going to be using, which provides this nice sparkly textured raised embossed area, is an embossing paste. Now the specific product is from a company called Viva Decor, and it's actually called Ferrogold. This is a new medium for me, but I have had a little play with it on a scrap piece of card because I needed to know whether it was going to stick of its own accord, and it certainly seems to. But I would advise, before you apply it to your actual component, just try a little bit on scrap card. What I wanted to show you though is that I've only applied a thin layer, so it may be different with a thicker layer, but actually it's quite bendable and flexy once it's had time to go off, and I thought that might be quite useful information for you to have. Now if, like me, you are new to embossing paste and you want to know a little bit more, I did find a video channel, a YouTube video channel, Jennifer Maguire Inc., and she does a really good, helpful video on embossing paste and stencils. So again, I'll put that in the description area in case you want to do a little bit more research in that area. Now before I turn my attention to my stencil, I actually need to create a secondary mask, because as you can see here, I'm also using a die cut shape, and the stenciling only occurs within the large circle of that die cut shape and to the left hand side of it. So the first thing that I've done is I've die cut one of my sketchy rings die cut shapes, and I've left it as intact as possible. So I've only removed the large central circle where I'm going to place that embossing paste, and that protects the surrounding areas. So the first thing that I'm going to do is to combine and layer up my stencil and my die cut shape that's acting as a secondary mask, and I'm positioning that on my stencil so that the area of the stencil that I want to emboss is nicely positioned within this large circle area. But I do also need to bear in mind that I want this certain aspects of this die cut shape to be on the top of my box. So I'm aware that these two little circles here, I want to be evident on the top of the box, and I want to have an even margin to the left of this particular little circle and the edge of the masked area, more or less equivalent to the edge of this other little circle and the edge of the masked area. So it's worth just taking a little time to get all that positioning right, so you're sure that, you know, your die cut shape that you're going to end up using is positioned where you want it to, and the embossed area in the center is what you desire to have in there. So I'm going to make sure that I've got that right off camera, and then I'll come back to you at the point that I'm ready to emboss. Now, just as a tip, before we start using our embossing paste, I do quite like to make sure before I start that I've got a bowl of soapy water available, just so that once I've finished, I can quickly just drop my stencil in there, and that cleans the embossing paste off it very quickly. So everything's positioned. I am a bit cautious with this because it's a new product for me, but it is simply just about taking some of that embossing paste and just working over the area where you want it to be on that stencil, really. So just covering it. It will take a reasonable thickness. I think it can vary. That lady's video suggested that you can put this on in different thicknesses. I tend to keep it fairly thin myself, but you know, it's always a personal choice. So there we go. Just make sure I've covered all that area. And at that point, once I'm happy with it, and I'm just concerning myself with that circle at the moment because my stencil isn't big enough to extend the whole area, I carefully remove my die cut shape because I do want to use that a second time. Then I can remove my stencil and drop that in the water. And I'd also like to remove some of this masking tape because I have found that, you know, once this dries off, this embossing paste, you don't get quite as clean a line in removing your masking tape. So I don't actually need that tape anymore to there. So I can take that away and get rid of it. And I can do the same up here. There we go. The beauty of that removable tape. So just cut away that area that's got that paste on it. And that now needs to be left to dry before we can go in for the second phase. Right, so now that that has had a little chance to go off, I will just talk you through setting everything up again for the second bit of embossed area that is to the left of this die cut here. So it is really just a repeat process, but I thought it might just clarify things to watch something through. So all you're doing is making a decision as to what you want to have embossed and placing your stencil accordingly. Now, it doesn't really matter if it goes over this area, although it is handy to have this outside area free so that you can more easily replace your die cut shape. So once you've decided on your area, you can use the existing embossed area to reposition your die cut shape. So I can see where that's going to go in there. So everything's lining up with the original set of embossing. And once that's done, you can then simply emboss that area to the left there. Now, I will do that off camera because it takes a little bit of time, but I have got a sort of test card here that I created, and this is showing you that you are going to end up with something that's looking a little bit odd, but it does just provide you with that relevant space for your die cut shape so that you can have that combination of interest on top of your box cover. So having achieved that, you're then going to be left with a space that your die cut shape will fit into nicely. So although it looks odd, it will all work out. So I'm going to get on with that task now, and then I can come back to you once that embossing paste is thoroughly dry. Right, so now that that embossing paste has been applied and has dried off, the rest of the embellishments are left until the very end of the project. So we can now get on and build our lid component. Now, what we need to be able to do is place our strengthening section so that it has that 1/8 inch frame around it. And we're going to be gluing that on the wrong side of this piece of card. And this is the reason why you do need to take care when you're positioning that masked off area, because if you don't get it central, then you may end up with an uneven frame at this point in the construction process. Now, because I know that we took care to place that centrally earlier, I have already placed my strengthening component in place where it's central, and just to save time, I've drawn a line all the way around it. So now what that means is I can simply apply some glue and position that within the pencil lines, bring up this at a right angle, and glue that in place. So, you know what gluing is all about now. I'm still using my PVA glue for these purposes. So I'll get that done off camera and come back to you. Right, so now that that's glued in place, if we turn it over, we can start to see that we're getting that nice 1/8 inch frame that we were looking for around that embossed area. Now, the next thing that I want to do is to cover this raw edge at the hinge side of the component. So in order to do that, I'm just going to trim away these corners. Now, I'm not going to go right up against the corner of this strengthening component. I'm going to leave about 1/8 inch gap. So it doesn't matter if it's a little bit more. I'm just trimming away that corner. I'll do the same this side. Now, at this point, I can apply my glue. I'm just showing you this because it's a new process in this project, and you know, if you haven't covered things before, you are going to need to see how this is done. So just get some glue along there. and we're just concerned with this back edge at the moment. So once that's in position, you just fold that over in the normal way, and I tend to use my bone folder as well, so it's a very similar process to that process that we used when we were covering the sides of our box base. So it's just a case of encouraging that card over that thick edge until it will take a hold with that glue. Now, when you get to these corners, if I show you here, you'll see that there's this extra bit of card over the edge of that strengthening component. So all we're going to do is we're going to push that down the side of that component and flatten it out at the end. If I get rid of some of that glue. I'll come back and show you that in a minute. And I do tend to work those quite a lot until I know that that's a good tight finish there. So I'm hoping that you can just see, you end up with this little tiny triangle folded over, and that's going to create a nice neat finish on the edge once we get to the next phase. So I'll just do this end. And that's preparing us for our hinge section. So we can now bring in our hinge component, and I'm going to do the gluing off camera, but I do just want to show you how you're positioning this. So with your right angle here, you're applying glue to this face, and you're going to attach that to this lid component so that the sides on three sides marry up with that strengthening section. This is effectively building up what were three layers of strengthening section to five. So that additional part of that hinge is just making up an extra two layers of that strengthening section. And when you're finished, you should have that right angle at the back with the top of your box. So I'll get that done off camera and come back to you. Okay, so now that that's all glued in position, the next thing I'm going to do is just take my bone folder and I'm going to draw around the edge of that strengthening section, which is very much like we did earlier in the project, to make that folding process a lot more easy, because we need to fold this card along those edges. So just very firmly. And the next thing we can do then is cut away the corners in the same way that we did with the back. So about an eighth of an inch away from the strengthening section. And all we're going to do now, and I won't do this on camera because you've already seen me do it with the back section. We're just going to apply some glue and fold these ends over and tuck these edges in. I'm going to do that on both ends first and then the front edge last. I opt to do this front edge last simply because it gives a neater finish along that front edge of the box, in my opinion. So I'll get that done off camera and come back to you at that stage. Right, so now that those edges have all been glued down, that's our lid component ready for that final stopper component that will be attached on the back. So that's what we're going to sort out next. Now for that stopper section, we need to accurately ascertain certainly the depth front to back of this aperture. We're not so concerned with the length end to end, it's front to back where we want that snug fit. So I've just opened up those base flaps to enable me to set that box down onto a firm base. The next thing that we're going to do is take a scrap piece of card with a nice right angle on it, and we're going to place that underneath that box so that one end is positioned against the short end of the box and then the back edge is positioned along the back edge of the box. Now, if you apply some pressure along the back edge of the box, as you draw that card, that box forward up against the card, you want to, if you press down, it will hit the edge of the card. You'll know it's made contact and it should inhibit the box from moving any further forward. So once you've got that position, you can then take your pencil and draw a line across the front edge of the box and then down the other end of the box. And that's going to give you a pencil mark that is the exact aperture. Now, we are going to be decreasing from this, but I do find that it's best to cut out the exact aperture first to make sure that we are actually on target. So I'm going to do that off camera and then I'll come back to you. Right, so I've cut my template to exact size, so that's my starting point. And at this stage, I do like to take my little pen trays and just slot them inside in the top. They might need a little bit of pushing into place, but it just, for me, it just seems to stabilize up the whole of the box section for me whilst I'm trying to fit this. Now, all I need to do now is to check that at some point along there, that edge, that card is a reasonably snug fit. So I can feel that there, it's tight edge to edge. So that's absolutely fine. And that's what I'm looking for. It's better to have it slightly tighter back to front than otherwise, because if you don't get a snug fit, then your box isn't going to stay shut. And if you've got a slightly too snug a fit, the cardboard is quite forgiving and it will just ease out a little to allow for that fit, and it will learn that position. So it's better to be slightly on the tighter side if in doubt. Now, end to end, that's an exact fit, but I actually want that to be looser than that, because if we get a snug fit back to front and that needs to pull outwards slightly, it will need to compensate by pulling in these ends a little. So you don't want pressure going that way and, oh, can't get my fingers right, that way. If you've got pressure that way, you definitely don't want any going that way. So we're going to have this section slightly shorter. So I'm going to trim this back, my initial template back, so that I have a gap that's about that amount before I start. So I'll do that now and then come back to you. Right, so this is my initial template now. I have still got to trim this back, but I want to show you how this is sitting in here. So if I lay it in lengthways first, I'm hoping that you can see that I can wiggle it backwards and forwards along that length. So I've got room in there. Not too short, but I've got room. Now, if I lay that in the box, I'm hoping that you can see how snug that is. So it will go flat, just, but it's snug. So that's what you're aiming for with your initial template. Now, having done that, I need to make an allowance for that cover. We're going to build up a strengthening section as we've done before, and we're going to cover it. So as we've done before, we need to make an allowance for that double thickness of cover front to back. So I will use my little section of card that I've glued together, a double layer of card, to ascertain, you know, how much I need to trim off one of these edges to reduce the width by that double thickness. Now, when it comes to the end section, we're actually going to remove four thicknesses of card. The reason for that is when we cover this section, we're going to do the long sections first. We're going to fold over the long sections first. So we're going to get that extra little bulk on either end where those little end bits are tucked down. So just to err on the side of caution, it's four thicknesses that we're removing from the the longer length. So two thicknesses of card from front to back, four thicknesses of card from the long length. And once you've got that, your template is finished. So I'm going to get to that stage off camera, and I will then cut out a further four pieces of card exactly the same and layer them up so that my strengthening component is prepared. You've seen how that works. I don't really think I need to demonstrate that on camera. It's just wasting your time. So I'll come back to you once that's sorted out. Right, so I've now finished that final strengthening section. And again, it's a thick component that's five layers of card thick. Now at this point, you can do one final check in the top of your box before you commit to covering it. So this is just going to give you confidence that you have got a good fit. So if I bring that up to the camera, you can see that there's plenty of room at that end for that component, so that it's not going to cause any pressure on the ends of my box at all. So I'm happy with that. Now the other thing that you can do is just take that little piece of card that's double thickness, glued together, two pieces glued together, and just put them in the space behind that component, and just make sure that you feel that that's grabbing along that length. And as long as that's happening, you're fine, and you can now turn your attention to covering that strengthening section. Now we do have a closer cover in that cutting list, and our strengthening section needs to get glued to the wrong side of that cover. But as you can see, it's a little bit uneven in its length, it's over length. So what I'm going to do here is just position this so that the strengthening section has an approximately equal frame on all three sides, and at this point I can then match up that frame at this end, draw a pencil line, only has to be rough, it doesn't have to be exact, and that's going to allow me to trim away that excess. So at that point, all I'm going to do, and I'll do this off camera, is wrong side of my card face up, closing strengthener component, glue that centrally in the middle there, and then once that's done, I can come back to you. Right, so as you can see, I have glued that component centrally on that piece of card, and because we've already covered components in this project today, I'm going to do that off camera. I have already covered one long length of this, and just as a reminder, all you're doing is you're cutting away the corners and you're spacing away that angled cut about the same sort of depth as the component that you're covering. So in this case, around and about an eighth of an inch. So you're doing all four corners like that. And then you're going to score down the side of your strengthening component to make that folding aspect a lot easier. Gluing up, folding up, and gluing to the surface. Now you're going to be doing the long sides first and finishing off with the two end pieces. So I shall get this component to that stage and then I will return to you. Right, so now that that component has been fully covered, we can just set it aside for a moment and start to focus on finishing our box off. Now the first thing we're going to do is establish a gluing line for our little pen trays. So those need to be put inside the box in position. But then we're going to push them further down into the box so that they protrude beyond the baseline by about an eighth of an inch, somewhere in that region. Now, once you've ascertained that, you can take a pencil and just draw around the top edge of those pen trays, just being careful not to mark the pen trays themselves. The line that you're drawing on the box now won't be visible when the pen trays are properly in position. This is just to give you an indication of where you can put the glue to later on. So just drawing all the way around those boxes. And at that point, we can remove those pen trays and set them to one side and bring in our hinge component. Now, in the interest of time, I have already applied glue to my hinge section, and I hope that you can see that I haven't been anywhere near as liberal as I normally am with my PVA glue. That's because you really don't want any glue to be oozing. You just want stickiness to create that bond. Otherwise, the lid is going to be sticking to the wrong pieces. So it's very simple. As long as you've kept that glue to a minimum, you can just line up the edges of the box so that these ends are nice and evenly spaced, and then just bring the hinge in to meet the back of the box, and you'll know that it's just sitting comfortably along that back edge there. And once that's in place, you've just got to give that glue a little time to go off and keep working it. And I will continue to do this off camera in the interest of time, because what you don't want is for glue to be oozing and sitting along here, and that's then going to start holding your lid in a closed position. You want your lid, definitely want your lid to be free to open to at least that sort of position, if not further back. So that's what you're just keeping an eye on whilst that glue is going off, and keep testing it and bringing your lid back until you're sure that you've still got full movement for that lid component. So I'll continue with that off camera and then come back to you when it's all set. Right, so now that I'm happy that that hinge is taken and there's enough flexibility of movement with it, I can now look at sorting out my little closer section. And this is why, you'll see exactly now why we have left our base open for all this time. Now, I have taken that closing section and I've already applied glue in the interest of time. I put plenty of glue in the middle there because it's a dip and I do want there to be adhesion, but I've been very careful around these outside edges because I don't want the glue to ooze onto my base component. Now, one of the things I would say is before you put this in place, just check all the edges and make sure that you can't feel any stickiness at all, because you don't want glue going all in the wrong place. So just check that before you put this in place. Now, at that point, you can just fit this component carefully, she says, into the top of this lid section, into the aperture where it needs to go, so that it's positioned where it needs to be. And at that point, we can close the lid down, turn the box upside down so you can see why that base has been left open, apply some pressure, and then we can lift that base off that position. And we know now that that closing section is in the right position. So it makes life a lot easier for us. So I'm now going to keep applying pressure until I know that that closing mechanism is firmly in place, and then I'll come back to you. Right, so with the closing section done, the next thing I have done, and I've done this off camera to save time, is I've gained access from the open base of my box, and I've just applied glue below that pencil line, drawing it away from the pencil line down towards the base. And I've done that on all four sides of the box internally. So this is going to be the glue that sticks my pen tray in place. So I just wanted to show you that. So once all that glue has been applied on all four sides, you can set the box down, take the pen trays and place them in the top of the box and just push down. Now, I actually do quite like to push these flaps down a little at the same time. I'll just get those in place and get rid of any excess glue first. So just get rid of the excess glue to start with. And now I am going to apply glue to these end flaps very quickly, just both the end ones, because they're going to stop that those pen trays from pushing beyond the baseline. If these flaps are in place, then the pen trays won't be able to drop lower than that baseline. So by just gluing these down. It's just something I've found out more recently. You don't have to do it this way, it's not obligatory, but I found it helpful. So pop those in place so that they're holding those pen trays in place. That's where they need to be. And place the box back down and start to just work the edges. I'm not really worried about these short edges. They're very strong and they will sort themselves out. But you do want these long edges to be stuck to either side of the box. So just press the base down from the inside and just keep applying pressure along the sides of the box. Now, you've heard me say it before, with PVA glue that is likely to take a little time. So I will continue to apply this pressure until that glue has gone off, and then I'll come back to you to finish off that base. Right, so now that my pen trays are firmly in position, I just want to come back to this closing component just to allay any fears really. Now, I've made a few of these boxes now, and what I have found is that this component can sometimes surprise you. It can be a bit more snug than you actually intended it to be. Now, the only explanation that I can really give you is that when we apply this to our lid section, we use quite a lot of PVA glue, and I can only think that the moisture from that glue gets absorbed into the card layers and causes them to expand a little, so that when you close your lid, it can seem to fit a little bit more tightly. However, it also seems to be the case that once that glue has had time to thoroughly dry off and shrink back, so that component seems to shrink back a little as well. So if you feel that that component is a little snug to start with, just leave the box in a closed position, so keep that lid closed. Leave it overnight if possible, and you'll probably find that the situation has eased in the morning. Right, so that just leaves our base flaps to finish the box. That's very straightforward, and I will leave you to get on with that and come back to you and sort out the embellishments. The only thing that I would say is before you apply glue, just make sure that there isn't any excess flap extending along the side of your box. If that's the case, just trim it back before you glue those flaps down, and then they can both go down in position, and that's your box ready for the final embellishment. And at that point, I'll come back to you. Right, so with the base all sorted out, we can now get on with our embellishments. Now, I am going to be talking you through a lot of these embellishments because it is simply a case of gluing them in place, and that does take up unnecessary time on camera. Now, as long as you know the order of things and where you need to put things, I think that's really all you do need to know. Now, having said that, I did used to struggle with gluing really delicate die cuts onto my projects without making a heck of a mess and getting glue everywhere. So I have now developed a technique that really works for me. So I will just share that with you in case you haven't come across it before, because it might also make life easier for you. So the first thing that we're going to tackle is one of these memory box sketchy rings die cut shapes. And you can probably see that I haven't actually taken out all of the little cutout inserts. I've left one on either side of that large circle. Everything else has been removed, but those have been retained. Now, if I place this in position in that space that was left by our embossing paste, you can see that there are areas of this die cut shape that extend beyond the box. So I can sort of make a mental note of that and hold on to that shape at that point, because I think it doesn't need to be glued beyond there. So the next thing I'm going to do, I'm just going to bring in a piece of absorbent tissue, or a kitchen towel in this instance, ready for when I need it. And all I'm going to do is liberally apply glue to this shape, and it will be much more than I actually need. So, these little insert shapes may come out, but I can glue them separately. It takes a little bit of time, but the main thing is that you do want to have stickiness on every aspect of the die cut shape, because otherwise it may not adhere in places. So I think that's the extent that I need to go to. So all I'm going to do now is make sure, just dab that glue, shift it about in order to make sure that it's got good coverage. So just moving it, making sure that all the green area is covered in white. So I think you can see that there's a lot of glue on there. So what I'm now going to do is place that on this absorbent towel so that the excess glue can be absorbed into that kitchen towel. And I can check that and do that a couple of times if I need to. So you can see there's a lot of the glue taken off. There's still one or two areas where that glue could potentially ooze onto my project. So I'll just lay it down again in those areas until I'm satisfied that there's not going to be any oozing going on. So that's really what you're looking for. As long as you've got stickiness, it's surprising, PVA will retain that dampness for a while, so you've got a little time to work with. So that's sort of what you're aiming for. Now at this point, we can just line everything up on our project using that space as an indication of positioning. Sometimes the die cuts do shift a little when they've got moisture on them. The card absorbs that moisture and slightly distorts the shape, but you can just encourage them into their position. And then just apply the pressure so that they slightly outside. Now I'm just going to apply that pressure all over there, and at that point I'm going to leave it to thoroughly dry out once I know that that's sorted, before I start trying to bend it around these edges. And the reason for that is, as soon as I start to bend these edges, it's going to start pulling on the flat area of the die cut shape and it will shift its position. So just leave it to dry out and take a hold and tackle the area over the sides once that's dried out. Right, so whilst that's drying out, we can have a look at some of the other embellishment die cuts. So one of the other die cuts that I've used in this design is a Cherry Lynn die cut. It's Paris Signs 4, and again, I'll put the information in the description area for you. Now, I don't know whether you can see, I have just used a part of that die cut. So if we pop these up the right way, so that you can perhaps make the comparison, that's actually all that I've die cut. So it's basically to here on that little ornate design piece. That's all that you need. Now, if we take a look at the box, the original box, you can see that die cut has come into play here. And we're actually only needing a part of it. So we can trim this back, but we do need to do it carefully because we are also going to be using this little arrow section, as I'll show you next. So the first thing that you need to do, you do need two die cuts of this shape. And we're just going to trim them back. So essentially either side of these little knobbly pieces. So I'm just going to round that off at that point, and that's rubbish. So get rid of that. And then again, on this side as well, I'm just going to round that rounded piece off so that I end up with an arrow section. And I need both of those pieces. So if you, so that needs to be reproduced to the same stage. Now the only remaining die cut used in this project is a Sizzix die cutter. It's a tag style die cutter. There's a set of 12 in this particular die cut, and it's 658612, but again, I'll put that in the description area for you. Now, I've actually just used this very small tag die cut, and you are going to need four of those. So I've got my four die cut shapes here, and the first thing that I'm going to do is take two of them and glue them together just to create a thicker component. At that stage, I'm then going to take this little arrow shape and glue that to the center here, just so that it's evenly positioned. And that's going to form these mock tabs once it's been cut down a little. So I'll get these to that stage and then come back to that point. Right, so they're now ready just to be trimmed back as necessary when we need them. So I'm just going to set those aside to dry out for the time being. All that means is we've got a little bit of extra trimming left to do on these shapes, because they're going to be too high for that hinge section with these little rounded sections in place. So we've got to remove them. And what I found is, as long as I sort of line up my scissors with the bottom of this little tiny internal circle, just that seems to straighten everything off. So that's all I'm going to be doing either end on both pieces. And then I can set those aside, ready for use later. So we can now turn our attention back to this sketchy rings die cut, because that glue will have thoroughly dried out by now. Now, it is simply a case of trimming these back and gluing them over the edge of that lid component. Now, I do just want to show you on this original, you're on the back where these hinge sections are, you're only gluing to just above the hinge section. You don't want to glue onto that hinge at all, because otherwise you're going to start inhibiting its action. So it's just over the edge there. Similarly at the front, just to mirror that, we are just going to glue to the bottom of that lid component. So it's just a case of trimming them all back to length, applying glue and putting them into place. So I'm not going to be doing any gluing, but I will just trim back this front one for you, just to give you an idea of what we're doing. So at this point, you can see they bend over very easily. You can, well, that's the actual back of the box, isn't it? It doesn't really matter. So I can actually use my nail to just make an indentation where that needs to be trimmed back to. And that's really all you need to do. You could use a knife or a blunt knife or something like that if you wanted to. It would have the same effect. So once you've achieved that, it's just the question of using that line as a guide and trimming back that component. Glue can then be applied to the underside of that and it can be glued into place. So that's all you're doing with that component, front and back of the box. So I'll get to that stage and come back at that point. Right, so that's making my box look a lot neater now that those edges are just glued down on those sides. So that means that we can start to look at this additional die cut on the end here. And that's still taken from the sketchy rings die cut that we've already used here. It's just this portion here that we're using. So it's just a partial die cut, as you can see. I've just taken that oversized at that point. Now, all I'm doing, I'm wanting to avoid having to glue down the sides on two of these edges. I just want to glue down on one edge. So I've just positioned that and tilted it in such a way that once that's dried out, the gluing will just be on this side and nothing on this side, and the rest will be on the back. So that is where I am going to glue that in place and then leave it to dry off before tacking the sides again. Now, I do like to add dimension to my box, and I absolutely understand if you don't do this because it is time consuming, but on this die cut only, I am actually adding a second die cut in the same position on top, just to make this die cut area slightly raised above this one. This one will remain as a single layer. So I'm going to do both of those things, get them in position, and come back to you at that point. Right, so with that job done, I've got three little bits of embellishments left here before I tackle my mock tabs and my little flat-sided pearls. So the first thing that I'm going to do, out of one of these, this spare die cut that I sort of only did a partial cut of, I've got this little section here that marries up with that. So all I'm going to do there is glue that over the top of that area, just again to add another layer and a little bit more depth. But I will do that off camera. So the next thing that I can do is tackle my hinges. And this is the approach that I take. So remembering, it, without opening the box, this is your hinge on the back here. So it's where you've got this additional ridge. Now, I actually should have told you as well, this top edge needs to be completely straight. So this little middle section also needs to be removed because that will get in the way of the hinge process. So what I'm going to do is actually use the point here and line that up with the base. So that's one area of positioning. The other thing I'm going to do, just to evenly space the hinges away from the corners and get a nice even thing, I'm just taking a scrap piece of card that is an appropriate width and using that as a spacer. So that will enable me to position my hinge on that side of things, and I can use that on the other end as well. Now, obviously I've got to remove that to glue it, and I'm going to lose my space. So all I'm going to do is gently raise that hinge upwards, double checking that area there, and then on a point, I'll bring that up to the camera, on a point, just below that point there, I'm going to make a pencil dot. And that means once I've glued that up, all I've got to do is line that dot up on the base over the pencil dot, and that's going to position my little embellishment correctly. So I will fit these off camera and then come back to you at that point. Right, so now that those hinge elements are nicely in place, we can apply a very similar technique to the front of our box for those faux tabs on either end. Now, the first thing that you are going to need to do is to take that tab component and trim it back. So you're taking a quarter of an inch section off the top of it, and that can be discarded. The next thing that you can do once you've established that size is use that as a template with the other tab section so that you end up with two tabs of exactly the same size. Now at this point, I tend to then glue the section up and use that spacer. You can use a different spacer size on the front if you want, it's entirely up to you. But I use that spacer then with my glued element just to place it in position, and then I can line it up, apply the pressure, and that is then positioned, and I can do the same to the other end. So I'll do that off camera and come back and we can look at the pearls. Right, so now we've got all our die cuts in place, we can now start to enter into the last phase of embellishment, which is our flat-sided faux pearls. Now these come in all colours and sizes, so you've got a wide variety out there, and I just got mine off eBay because I found them quite good value there. Now the sizes that we're going to be using on this particular project, the largest are 4 millimeter in diameter and the smallest 2 millimeter in diameter. So we've got 2, 3, and 4 millimeter flat-sided faux pearls. Now I will just show you the original box and let you have a look at that design in case you want to reproduce it. And you could perhaps take a screen dump so that you've got something to refer to. Now, other than the design, the only thing I feel I can really help you with is the technique that I use to apply them to the box. So, you know, I'm just going to show you with the smallest and most fiddliest of these pearls, and then hopefully you can find your way from there. Now, first of all, because these tiny 2 millimeter pearls are so small, I do swap over to a very fine needle nose glue bottle. It's not as squeezy as my other glue bottle, so I also tend to leave it on its side so that the glue is closer to the nozzle. Additionally, I keep a damp sponge to hand because it's the moisture that I use to collect those little pearls from their tray. I also like to have my beads all ready to go and make sure that at least several of them are dome shaped up, because that's the way I'm going to be picking them up and placing them on my project. So there, I'll keep them there where you can see them. Now, ordinarily, I do like to do two or three of these pearls at a time. So I will work from left to right. That way, whilst they're drying off, I can still continue to work and I'm not going to be knocking them out of their positions. So the first thing that I do is I take my pencil, and wherever I want to place a pearl, I just put a pencil dot. So I've just got a couple in there now because I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I put a little dot there and a little dot there, and they're both going to take a 2mm flat-sided pearl. And the next thing I do is I just put a little bit of glue onto the top of those pencil dots. And it's just a small amount because those little pearls really don't require much glue at all. Now at that stage, I'm just going to very slightly dampen my fingers. So I've dampened them off and I've dried them off. I just want a hint of moisture there, that's all I need. It's only enough to pick up a pearl in that moisture. And then I can turn that over the glue, and the glue will actually take over, the moisture of the glue will actually take over from the pulling of that pearl. Oops, it's not doing that. Typical, isn't it? So I'm just going to use a little bit of card to encourage that off my finger. We'll try again. So the tiniest amount of moisture, to gently pick that up, place it over the glue, and the glue just takes over. So that's what normally happens. So it is handy to have a piece of card in case you need something to help lever that pearl off your finger. So I think that's all the help that I can really give you with that. Now I will finish the project, and I have got another couple of colorways that I can also show you in case you're not that keen on green. So I'll get all those pearls in place and then I'll come back to you at that point. Right, so that's my project all finished. All the pearls are in place, all the embellishments are in place. And if I open it up, there's my little pencil. Nice and safe and sound. And if I close that up and just turn the box upside down, you can see that that lid is a really good fit. So the only thing I need to do now is show you some colorways, as I promised I would. Now you've already seen this green and navy one today, and they're all gold inside, incidentally. I did stick with that theme throughout this project. So that's that one. I've also got a purple one here, which I've kept very subtle by using all the embellishments in the same colorway. So that sort of gives a different sort of impact as well. Finally, I've gone for quite a contrast with this pink and black version. And so that's just another idea for you. So that's everything for this tutorial, and that just leaves me to remind you about that PDF document, which is also available to help you with this box. As always, I do want to thank you for your time, which is very much appreciated. I know these are long tutorials, so thank you for that. And I also hope that you'll be able to join me for future projects which are coming up